All righty, good morning, everybody. Thank you very, very much for coming out here. And the world of stroke has come a huge way, because when I first started speaking about stroke, I had audiences well in the 4 to 6 people range, and this is really tremendous. All righty, so I just wanted to let you know that I have only one major disclosure, and that is that I'm very honored to be here today with my colleagues and with all of you, so thank you all for coming. I'd like to talk a little bit about emergency medicine pre-hospital systems and kind of the screening tools that they use in the pre-hospital environment, and to kind of figure out, you know, how they actually make decisions on who to transport where and when and what time frame. And so, you know, clearly 12 minutes is more than enough to discuss this topic. and you'll understand why at the end. So we all kind of are here because we know that strokes are fairly common, that that there's a fairly high mortality with strokes. It's the number 2 killer in the world, and it's number 4 in the United States, and that there's a significant morbidity to it. And that morbidity, it translates to 6.5 million stroke survivors in the United States. And really the amount of disability that it causes is really our major problem in managing strokes. And so all of our effort really is to decrease the disability as well as do our best to decrease mortality in the acute stroke patients. We also know that that with a large vessel occlusion, an LVO, which is becoming, you know, the term that we all hear on a daily basis, that that you have severe ischemia to the brain, and that this ischemia is very time dependent, and that you lose about 1.9 million neurons per minute in a large vessel occlusion. About 14 billion synapses, and then about 7.5 miles of axonal fibers per minute of occlusion. So time is clearly very important. Now, having that background, I would just like to kind of go over, for those of you that don't live in the EMS world, you know, how things are organized in EMS. It kind of started back in the 60s and 70s, when people realize that your chances of dying from a motor vehicle accident on the highway was greater than if you had gotten shot in combat in Vietnam. And from that point, they said, we really have to do something about this. And back then, the ambulances were also hearses, and they were just, you know, large station wagons, and that was the extent of our EMS system, and it was very informal. So there was legislation passed in 1966, and again in 73, the big EMS Act of 1973 created our EMS systems. But these systems are under local control, and the state, each state creates local regions called MCAs, and the MCAs are medical control authorities, and they're made up, the medical control authorities themselves are made up of all the hospitals in that region that actually have their doors open 24/7 to receive patients. And so these committees in each region make up all of their protocols and certain rules, but then those are supervised by the state so that there's some consistency and some minimal correlation to what the state wants for EMS care. The funding for these things varies, you know, extremely widely from community to community. It could be public, could be private, or it could just be volunteer services. And the way they're organized is extremely variable based on their resources. So in some communities, you have people that are both firemen and paramedics, and in other places, those two are separate. And the amount of training for paramedics varies tremendously also. The other thing is that they work on protocols, and the protocols may be either online, meaning that there's a physician on the phone or through some kind of telemetry process with them, or they could just be run by protocols where the paramedics go in the field and just run what they do based on pre-established protocols. So the training for these people is extremely variable. And if you take a look around the United States, there's over 30 types of paramedics that are operating out in the field. But we kind of divide them into kind of 3 levels. A basic, which has about 100 hours of training, and this person can go out and do CPR, intubate, and they have AEDs with them, these automatic defibrillators. An intermediate, who can do a little more, they have 300 hours of training, and they can do IVs and certain medications and EKGs, and then a full paramedic with over 1,000 hours of training that can has extended use of medication. So it depends on the resources of the individual community that you live in that actually dictates what the level of training is for your pre-hospital care personnel. So I'd like you to kind of imagine yourself sitting in your living room watching the Lions game. And clearly, you know, I know these guys aren't watching the Lions because they're all smiling. And so I know that this is a little bit of a stretch. However, assume that you're kind of on a Sunday afternoon at home with your family watching, watching TV, hanging out, and all of a sudden you have a stroke and you can't move. And you can't talk, and you're not really sure what's going on. You know, what is it that you would like to happen if you were stuck in that position? You know, and I think that putting yourself into the patient's point of view kind of helps you develop ideas about what we should do to respond to patient care needs. And that's kind of a real panic situation. And what you're hoping for is that somebody recognizes that you're not right, even if you can't, you know, really talk. And it's very different. It's not like a heart attack where you can go, oh my God, my chest is hurting, or, you know, or if you got shot and you're, you know, dripping blood on the floor, people notice. And so you wanna make sure that your family members know what's going on and that you get their attention and that they actually call 911. And that when they call 911, the person who's answering the phone at 911, the dispatcher, understands that this could be a stroke and that you actually get the right resources out to that patient, and that the paramedics or the EMS people get there very fast, and that once they're there, they figure out what's going on and get you and maybe a family member to the right place. So getting, you know, the right person to the right place in the right time is absolutely key. And, you know, recognizing the symptoms is not as easy as you think, and we kind of struggle with this all the time. If you have an MI, you know, you have an EKG that tells you exactly what's going on, and you have patients with symptoms, and if you get stabbed or shot, you know, you have obviously the trauma that that gets you in. And this young man who was eviscerated was actually a patient that I took care of. And of course, you know, when he got stabbed and eviscerated on the street, everybody, you know, noticed it and panicked and called EMS, and we got all these systems going. We got, you know, the trauma surgeons, anesthesia, a resuscitation room, and we basically took the guy up and you, you know, run his bowel and rinse him out and tuck it back in, and they have a 2% mortality. And with the stroke patients, you may have up to a 20% mortality at 1 year, and nobody's really kind of, you know, getting in a rush or panicking. So I think that with the current treatments we have, we need to change that paradigm. So you want your people to actually recognize that there's something wrong with you, and that's the face, arm, speech, and time kind of thing, and hopefully they'll learn about that. And you want them to call 911. So Bill Barson many years ago actually figured out that if you call 911, that's the fastest way to get into the emergency department. And that if you call your private physician, that's the slowest way to get into the emergency department. And yet that's kind of, you know, your natural reflex is to call your doctor. So that you kind of have to change that a little bit. So our expectations of EMS are that they actually get there in time. They figure out what's going on with the patient and get them to the right place. The dispatchers really need to use very focused questions to get to the bottom of what's happening with the patient so that they can tell the paramedics, you know, what kind of run they're on, and they can prepare for it. And really one of the most difficult things is to figure out when was the patient last normal. So if you're sitting in your living room and you can't speak and you can't move, nobody notices that there's something wrong. So they'll have to go back, oh yeah, right, you know, half hour ago he got up and went to the bathroom, and that's that. Now that becomes your time. So once the paramedics get there, they have to deal with the ABCs, the airway, breathing, circulation, and they actually look at your C-spine also to make sure that there's no associated trauma with this. They check your glucose, you know, and then they may operate on a protocol, or they may call in. They also have to kind of do some kind of pre-hospital stroke scale, and there are two kinds. One that actually helps you identify a stroke, and one that actually tries to help you identify if there's a large vessel occlusion or not. And as you can see, there's a ton of these things out there. And so this slide is not intended for you to really understand any of these things, whereas this slide is. And so you can see that all of these scales have been tested. They all have their sensitivities and specificities, likelihood ratios, positive and negative, you know, and they all kind of compete with each other for, you know, which is the best one. But the fact that there's so many of them means that none of them are really sufficiently adequate to do what you really want to do, which is, you know, you need a psychic with you to know if there's a large vessel occlusion when you first show up at the patient's house. So really, you have to kind of look at these, and I know that over time there's going to be more and more data on this. There's a couple validated ones, the Cincinnati Prehospital Stroke Scale and the Los Angeles Prehospital Stroke Screen, that have undergone some testing, and Steve Levine's group has kind of done these graphs and looked at all the data on them and has created receiver-operator curves that tell you how good their sensitivity is and how low their false positive rates can go. And, you know, the LAPS score, the Los Angeles Prehospital Stroke Scale, has an 86% sensitivity and a 99% specificity, which I think is really, you know, pretty good. Cincinnati, though, is much, much more simple. It's not an 11-item score. It's a 3-item score, and it's at 80% sensitivity and 88% specificity. So I think for that scale being as simple as it is, it's really quite effective. And so this is the two comparisons. So in pink is the LA stroke scale, and in blue is the Cincinnati stroke scale. And you can see these are all various studies that have mapped out their various characteristics. So it's not really important to know this right now, but what's important to know is that the American Heart has come up with an algorithm that basically says when EMS arrives, they have to examine the patient, and they should do some kind of screen to actually decide if it's a stroke. And then if you think it's a stroke, you should do a screen to decide if it's a large vessel occlusion. And if it's a large vessel occlusion and they're within 6 hours, and that paradigm is changing, and we'll hear more about that today, then you should transport them to an institution that actually can do a thrombectomy and has endovascular therapy if it only adds another 15 minutes of transport onto your already usual transport time. And so that's kind of the American Heart algorithm, and they've worked on this for a long time, and there's data supporting each box and each circle. But I think one of the interesting things that has just recently developed is something that was published just recently by Andrew Asimos in North Carolina, and Bogle, who's an epidemiologist, and they basically created a simulation. And so they know that the person is gonna call 911, EMS is gonna be dispatched, and that when they arrive, they're going to do an on-scene score and look for an LVO. And if it's not there, they're going to transport to the nearest hospital. And if it is there, they're going to transport to the nearest endovascular center. And in this model, what you can do is actually look at your stroke prevalence in your county and create simulations for various patients based on where they live, what their odds are of having a stroke. And then you can actually plug in various different transport times, various different times of day, and then they will use MapQuest to figure out what the transport times will be. And then you can use various different stroke scales. So you can actually use this model for your own community. And they actually looked at two counties, Mecklenburg County, which is Charlotte, North Carolina, and then King County, which is Seattle. And Seattle has a fair amount of mountainous regions around it that are hard to transport. And they tried to figure out their over-triage rate, which is how many people are you gonna actually over-triage to endovascular centers that could have gone to their local or their closest primary stroke center. And the over-triage rate for Mecklenburg County was between 13 and 55%, and for King County was 10 to 40%. And it's interesting that you can't make a single statement about everybody in the country. What you can say is that every environment's different, and you need to figure it out in that environment and model for that environment. And they came up with this like number needed to route. So how many people do you need to route to a center that can do endovascular therapy in order to get one LVO patient there? And so using the LAMS score, it was about 2.6. Using the RACE score is about 5.3. And using CSTAT, which is another Cincinnati scale, it was 9.3. And so depending on your environment, right, because Cincinnati wants everybody to come to them. And so, but the thing is that you have to decide what's an acceptable false positive rate. How many LVOs are you willing to send to places that don't have endovascular? So ultimately, as I finish up here with my conclusion, there's extreme variability in systems. There's no consensus on which stroke scales to use. You have to get involved. It took 5 years to do the TPA study and 20 years to implement it, so get working. And as a transition, I would just like to say, the big parameters are onset to reperfusion, and it's an entire system. And so we're hopefully gonna hear about how to cut that system short by field treatment. Thank you.